Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for your patience. Apologies for the slightly late start here. Thank you all for being here and for gathering and convening today. Rob Bonta, California Attorney General, and excited to be right here at Dale's Senior Center. I know we'll have an opportunity for some conversation after the press conference is over, but we're here in recognition of Elder Abuse Awareness Day and want to make some important statements about ways that our seniors, our beloved seniors, can protect themselves from abuse and how we as partners are doing our part to support our seniors from the many forms of abuse, unfortunately, that are occurring in California and beyond. And before I get into some of my remarks, I want to say that we never do anything alone. We always seek to work in partnership and collaboration. We feel we are better, more impactful, and stronger in our work when we do so. So let me thank some of our partners that are here today. We have AARP Regional Director Luis Campillo, and he'll be making some remarks shortly. You'll hear from him. We have Riverside Police Chief Larry Gonzalez, and we also have with us today Garrett Bethel and Maria Loera from Riverside County Department of Public Social Services. So I want to thank them for coming together as part of a great team here today for what I believe is a very important and relevant reminder about elder abuse, how prolific it is, and how damaging it can be. And one of the things I think I really want to say is it's important to talk about elder abuse. Sometimes there is stigma, shame, embarrassment. No one should be shameful. Or feel stigma or be embarrassed about being the victim of elder abuse. The only people who should be embarrassed and shamed are those who are perpetrating elder abuse on others. So as a victim, you've done nothing wrong. You should reach out to folks who can support you and hold those accountable and those who can help you heal. Every year, one in 10 older Americans experience abuse, neglect, or exploitation. That amounts to 5 million of our parents, our grandparents, our loved ones, our neighbors. Those statistics are statistics, and behind every one of those numbers is a person who's been hurt. It's sickening, and it's very scary. Whether we see it or not, victims of elder abuse are all around us. They're often suffering in silence, as I just referenced. It can come at the hands of a family member. It can come from an at-home caregiver, from a nursing home, or a stranger online, on the phone. The scams are coming from anywhere and, unfortunately, everywhere. It can be in the form of physical, sexual, emotional, or financial abuse. It's easy to miss, it's very harmful, and it's completely unacceptable. Unfortunately, there is one form of abuse that is most common and at the same time least reported and among older people, and that is financial abuse. So let's talk about that for a moment. Each year, older adults lose nearly $3 billion to financial frauds and schemes. That was with a B, $3 billion. Call center fraud, investment scams, romance scams, identity theft, predatory lending, home improvement and estate planning scams. The types of scams seem almost endless. The list is lengthy, and the perpetrators are creative. They're nimble. There are new scams that are coming online. They're running their schemes online, over the phone, and in person, in all types of ways. They can be big operations or as small as slipping cash out of a nursing home resident's wallet. We've seen it all. According to the FBI, there were more than 88,000 reported victims of fraud over the age of 60 just last year. And those are just the ones who reported, just the ones who came forward. We know many, as I mentioned, suffer in silence. And the total losses increased by 84% since 2021. So the losses are increasing, the number of victims increasing as well. Many fell victim to call center scams. That's a common scam. We all get them. But they prey on older folks in particular. The fraudsters behind these calls often pose as tech or customer support, or sometimes as an official government entity. Last year, almost half of call center scam victims were over 60, and they made up 69% of the losses, totaling more than almost $1 billion, $724 million. Another common scam comes in the form of investment opportunities that are sold as too good to pass up. Please give me your money. You're sure to get a positive return. The risk is very low, if there's any risk at all. Low-risk, high-reward scams, they're Ponzi schemes, pyramid schemes, real estate and investment scams, and the like. If they seem too good to be true, they probably are. So your antenna should be raised when you're getting those promises of huge returns and zero or low risk. They're frequently run online. They pressure older people to tap into their savings, sometimes to reach into their home equity and their retirement accounts that they've spent their life saving up for. These are funds that are usually limited, and once they're depleted, they're hard to replace. Last year, these types of scams resulted in 4,500 reported victims, over 60, totaling just under $1 billion. Then there's romance or confidence scams, people who pretend to have a close, romantic or intimate relationship with someone online and then take advantage of that emotional vulnerability to swindle them, to scam them. Last year, more than 7,000 victims, over 60 reported romance scams, losing just shy of $419 million. And while some pose as a love interest, others pretend to be a family member, a grandchild, a niece, a nephew in need of urgent financial help. I need it now. I need to get bailed out of jail. I have a medical emergency. In 2022, almost 400 people, over 60, were victims of what are known as grandparent scams, losing about $3.8 million. So these are just some of the more common frauds we've heard of. There are certainly others. This isn't meant to be exhaustive, although I know it seems overwhelming and intimidating. There's also fake prizes to claim, lottery winnings to take home, and sweepstakes, giving away lavish rewards. So there's all types of different scams. Impersonations of loved ones and friends, online shopping scams, false advertisements for products that don't exist, extortion, cryptocurrency-based scams, all part of the litany. And sadly, we know there are more people, again, who haven't come forward, more scammers that haven't been brought to justice at this time. So what can you do? How do you protect yourself? How do you protect your loved ones? I know these numbers seem daunting. I just threw a lot of statistics at you to make sure that we understood the scale and breadth and scope of the problem. And I'm not here to scare you, just to make sure that you're aware and that you can take steps to prevent the scams, to not be a victim, to defend yourself. And so we're here to make everyone aware of the risk and make sure you know how to avoid getting caught in a scammer's web. So what can we do? The biggest advice is to be guarded with your personal information and money. And don't share your social security number, your bank account, or financial information with strangers or with entities who call out of the blue with vague information, claiming to need it, and often to need it now. Shred documents that contain such information so they're not available to others. Ask for more information when limited information is provided to you. Get names, get contact information, the company or organization involved. Cross-reference and verify information that's given to you. There's a lot online, so look up the person that is reaching out to you. Look up their name to see if it's legitimate. Never share your passwords, not to bank accounts, not to email accounts, even to library accounts. Monitor your bank statements and your credit cards to see if there's anything out of the ordinary, something you don't recognize that's happening. Hang up on unwanted calls. Ignore unexpected text messages and consider a blocking service if you're getting spammed with scams. Anyone getting spammed with scams? Okay, so you can get those blocked. I know all of you can raise your hand. Don't click on links and texts or emails from anyone you don't know. Pause before sending money to a grandchild, relative, or friend who is reaching out online. First give them a call to double check that it's them, and it's really them who is in need. That's a common scam. Never send cash. Never send gift cards or gift card numbers. Don't wire transfer your money or send cryptocurrency to an online love interest. Know that no government agency will ever ask you to wire them money. If someone is claiming to be a government agency and they're saying, wire me money and wire it to me now, they're not a government agency. It's a scam. Beware of Medicare schemes. Before sharing any information, call Medicare directly to make sure it's legitimate. 1-800-MEDICARE. Call them to confirm. Be careful with what and how much you share online on your social media posts, including especially posts of a personal nature. Scammers will use that information to claim to be a family member and to try to scam you and take advantage. If you're the victim of a scam or have been taken advantage of, don't keep it to yourself. As we just mentioned, don't suffer in silence. Report it. There are people who are here to help you, to support you. You can call my team, the Department of Justice's Division of Medi-Cal Fraud and Elder Abuse. We have a hotline, 800-722-0432. So reach out to us. We can help. You could also send us a complaint online, oag.ca.gov/complaint. oag.ca.gov, that's the general one. You can also send it to oag.ca.gov, DMFEA/reporting, and we'll make these available to you. Don't expect you to be writing down these phone numbers and email addresses. You can also report it to the Federal Trade Commission at reportfraud.ftc.gov. So there's a number of places you can go to, you can turn to for help, for support, for follow-up, and for accountability. Scammers are smart. They are conniving. They are persistent. Always be vigilant for yourself and your loved ones. At California's DOJ, we're committed to protecting older Californians from scams, putting an end to all forms of elder abuse, supporting survivors, and holding perpetrators accountable. In 2020 and 2021 alone, our Division of Medi-Cal Fraud and Elder Abuse conducted more than 2,700 investigations, filed more than 150 criminal cases, and secured 131 criminal convictions. We've been busy. It's also a testament to how much fraud and scams and abuse is out there. We're prosecuting caretakers who abuse their roles to steal from clients. We're standing up to nursing facilities that prey on our seniors and issuing guidance on how to identify and report elder abuse. As our older population grows, this work is critical, and our older population is growing. It's estimated that by 2030, people over 60 will make up 25% of California's population. It's a blessing to have our loved ones live longer. It also means we have a responsibility to make sure their long lives are happy, rewarding, and safe, that they are protected. The nation-leading work being done and being led by my DMFEA is an incredible start, but we know there's more to do. And we can't do it alone. We all have a role to play, to do our part, to pitch in. We need to talk about this issue. On Elder Abuse Awareness Day, and every day, not just today, but every day, it's an important issue that we need to be talking about and raising awareness about. We need to keep an eye out when checking on our elderly loved ones. We need to teach our loved ones how to be on alert for scams and for frauds, online, on the phone, and in person. And we need to strengthen protections that prevent these crimes from happening in the first place. After spending decades taking care of our families and contributing to our communities, our elders deserve to spend their golden years in peace and in dignity. Together, we can and we will make that a reality, but we have our work cut out for us. I want to thank you for the opportunity to spend time with you to share some information that I believe is very important. Please know that we care, and we're here if you need us at the California Department of Justice and all of our team members here. And I'd like to introduce one of those team members now. I want to turn it over to AARP Regional Director Luis Campillo to say a few words. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Attorney General Bonta. Thank you for setting the context and for your leadership on this important issue. Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here on behalf of AARP California and our 3.2 million members here in this Golden State. Any AARP members in the audience, raise your hands. Excellent. Thank you so much for your membership, and thank you so much for being here this afternoon with us. So as you may know, AARP is the largest national nonprofit, nonpartisan organization, and we really are dedicated to empowering people to choose how they live as they age. And with our focus on health security, financial stability, personal fulfillment, AARP California advocates on behalf of older adults and their families on the critical issues that they really care about, such issues as caregiving, affordable and accessible housing, lower prescription drug prices. We also work to make our communities more livable for Californians of all ages and abilities. Some of our most important work happens in helping older adults and their families protect themselves against frauds and scams through our Fraud Watch Network. The AARP Fraud Watch Network is a free resource for all. You don't have to be a member. We equip consumers with up-to-date knowledge to spot and avoid scams, and we connect those targeted by scammers with our fraud helpline specialists who provide support and guidance on what to do next. We also advocate at the federal, state, and local levels to enact policy changes that protect consumers and enact and enforce laws. We also offer educational workshops and provide webinars, teletown halls, and in-person events where you can hear directly from fraud experts. There are many con artists out there, as the Attorney General mentioned, and they're increasingly sophisticated, creative in their methods. They are like viruses. They're able to continuously evolve their response based on news and trends. So finding more ways to separate us from our cash and our personal information. And as you heard from the Attorney General, there are many different kinds of scams out there, from home repair to romance scams to calls claiming to be from a relative or friend, or the IRS requesting gift cards, bank information, or money wires. Again, if you receive a call, a text, an email, a letter that seems a little fishy or that's urgently asking you for action to do something, it's important for you to step back and don't respond. Warning signs to look out for, as have been mentioned before, include that incredible urgent demand for money, for a gift card, for personal information like your social security, your bank accounts, your credit card information. Again, we recommend that you keep that information, your personal information, never give it over the phone or mail or internet unless you were the one that initiated that contact. And again, protect yourself by checking your credit report annually and your bank and credit card statements frequently. And remember, the government will never ask you to pay for something with a gift card or threaten that they're on their way to arrest you if you don't pay. The best thing that you can do when you get that type of suspicious call is to hang up and report it. The more information authorities have, like the ones represented in this press conference today, the better they can identify patterns, link cases, and ultimately catch the criminals. And if you or a relative are victims of a fraud, there are a number of steps that you can take, including filing a police report, contacting the credit bureaus to place a fraud alert, closing any fraudulent accounts that were open on your name, and filing a complaint with a Federal Trade Commission. And if you suspect that something may be a scam, you can always contact the AARP Fraud Watch Network, and our helpline number is 877-908-3360. The number again is 877-908-3360. Or you can also go online and see aarp.org/fraud for more information and to sign up for the watchdog alerts, where you will get information on new scams and we offer tips to protect yourselves and your loved ones. So we hope that you never become a victim to a scam, but if you do, you're not alone, and AARP is here to help you. And with that, I would like to turn it over to Chief Larry Gonzalez with the Riverside Police Department. Thank you.
Thank you and good afternoon. The good thing about going last is everything's been said already. But I want to bring it down to a local level for my friends here at Dale Senior Center in the city of Riverside. So I will touch on some of the things that have been said by the Attorney General already, but just kind of let you know what's going on in our city as well. First of all, recognizing the scam attempt is the first way to protect yourself from being a victim. Most scams are old, but with new technology and tactics. You find these guys are trying to help you navigate through your technology or help you get your password. Help me get this by giving me your password. And it's scary. Technology is scary. It scares me. You know, we didn't grow up with that. But now these guys will try to make you feel like they're your friend and navigate through your technology or your computer to give you their passwords. There are many governmental websites that we heard earlier that we will list and describe different types of scams. They will list that, including the Department of Justice website, as well as websites on your on our website as well, the Riverside Police Department website. Many banks and other financial institutions have information online to help educate seniors on different scams and how to better protect yourself. Reporting suspected fraud helps enforcement try to catch these scammers and to try to cover up any financial issues, but also to prevent them from victimizing other people. On a side note, please remember, it was just said earlier, that law enforcement will never call or text you in an attempt to get money from you. The Riverside Police Department is not going to call you and say, if you don't do this, we are going to stop your credit card. I don't even know how to do that. Or we're going to put a warrant in the system for your arrest. That's not the way we operate. We'd rather catch you by surprise if we really wanted to arrest you. But it's perfectly understandable why an elderly person would be hesitant to report that they think they've been victimized, right? The fear of losing the care that you need could be one. Getting a family member in trouble if it was them that victimized you. Family members often get angry with victims for sending funds. The possible embarrassment of someone finding out about it and thinking that you cannot take care of yourself. The scammers will spend a great deal of time trying to befriend a victim, and the victim will think they're betraying their friend if they don't do what they're asking them to do. The victim is enticed to believe that they also want a car, along with a lottery or sweepstakes. The suspects tell the victim they need to pay for such things as shipping, title, taxes, fees, etc., on the vehicle that you just won. So how do you report that you are a victim or know someone who is a victim of a possible scam? Brought that up a few times, it's worth mentioning again. Our economics crimes investigators prefer that you report the potential confirmed fraud to us, the police department. That gives us the best chance to intervene if necessary, and our detectives and officers will make the mandated reports to the Adult Protective Services for their review and follow-up. You can also report the matter directly to Adult Protective Services, and what they will do is they will cross-report the matter to the appropriate law enforcement agency. Family members and friends are also encouraged to make a report to police or APS if they reasonably believe their elderly friend or loved one is being scammed. Now, on a personal note, I was recently contacted by a friend who wanted to report a suspected sweepstakes lottery scam from their elderly family member who they might have been a victim of. The elderly victim received a call that she won the Publisher's Clearinghouse sweepstakes. This was actually the same day, around the same time, that they actually named the real winners of the Publisher's Clearinghouse sweepstakes. The scammer told the victim she also won a brand new luxury car and would need to pay some fees to receive that car and additional sweepstakes winnings. Over the next several weeks, unfortunately, the elderly victim mailed several cashier's checks that totaled well over $200,000, pretty much her entire life savings. Victim said that the suspect was her friend and that she was convinced that it was all legitimate. This case highlights the importance of family to keep a close eye on their elderly loved ones and also keep them updated on different types of scams that they're vulnerable to or they could fall victim to. I saw firsthand how an elderly victim and her family feels after she was swindled out of her money, especially a large sum like that. It's heartbreaking. Fortunately, their family was able to catch the scam before it went any further, and our detectives are working feverishly to identify who was responsible for this case. This is why we're here today, to bring awareness to our senior community and so that you don't become the next victim. Thank you all for being here.
Well, thank you. I hope that some of the information we've shared and tools we provided will help those watching and those present protect yourself from scams and potential abuse. And please also know that the prevention is the best outcome, never happening in the first place, but we know it does happen. And so when it does, don't suffer in silence. Reach out, and hopefully law enforcement can get some outcomes for you. I also want to say I have an 85-year-old mother who I love dearly, and one of the things that I love about her is that she's loving and she's trusting. And that has led her to be a victim of scams in the past. It's okay to be loving and trusting. I'll also say trust, but verify. Follow up and be cognizant of reality. There are people trying to scam you, unfortunately. So be vigilant, be cognizant, protect yourself. Hopefully you'll never be a victim. With that,